Hachette Audio presents Nick Drake, The Life, written and read by Richard Morton Jack. Foreword read by Gabrielle Drake.
This is not an authorized biography. That term implies to me a straitjacketed affair, tailored by the estate, family, or subject themselves to fit a desired image of the protagonist. This has not been the case with Richard Morton Jack's biography of my brother. But it is true that this is the only biography of Nick Drake that has been written with my blessing. When Callie Callaman, the manager of Nick's musical estate, and I published our own book about Nick, Remembered for a While, we meant this collection of fragments and memories to set a few records straight and rectify some of the absurd myths that had grown up around Nick's life. But it also revealed the need for a more conventional biography, one that accurately told the story of Nick's brief life. This was certainly not a task that I wanted to or could undertake. But it posed a dilemma, because if such a biography were to be truly accurate, it would mean allowing access to hallowed grounds and household gods, and asking a stranger to tread softly because you tread on my dreams. Nick Drake's story has too often been overshadowed by the tragedy of his final illness. There was nothing romantic about it. Like most mental illnesses, it was grim, repetitive, and relentless, and it cruelly robbed him of his creative muse. It caused him despair and a lifetime of grief for those closest to him. But if there is an interest in his short life, it surely lies in those years that led up to his illness, the years in which the seed of his talent was planted, nurtured, and brought to full bloom in three albums of songs that have blazed a trail long after his sad death. It is these years that have never before been accurately analysed and chronologically documented. Throughout the life of Nick's music, one of the miracles has been the nourishment and care it has received, both before and after his death, from strategic players, all of them outstanding people in their own right. Apart from our exceptional parents, and a fine housemaster who saw his potential despite his poor academic results, there was his meeting at Cambridge almost by chance with the fellow undergraduate and music scholar whose arrangements became integral to his songs, Robert Kirby. There was his introduction to his producer, the remarkable Joe Boyd, who, despite all setbacks, has never ceased to champion Nick's music. And there was his master sound engineer, John Wood, who became one of his closest friends and who has protected both Nick and his work ever since. Thanks to Joe Boyd, Nick was signed to Chris Blackwell, world famous for his Island record label. And thanks to Island, a quarter of a century after Nick's death, its creative director, Callie Callaman, took on the mantle of manager of the Nick Drake musical estate, which, at his suggestion, we have called Brighter Music. It is Callie who has expertly guided Nick's music ever since, and it is to Callie in large part that Nick owes his posthumous fame. And now Nick owes him the discovery of another key player in his saga, that of the storyteller. In Richard Morton Jack, Nick has, I do believe, once again struck gold. Callie met Richard many years ago through a joint love of record collecting, and gradually became aware of his rare ability to combine a copious knowledge of the history of music with a forensic facility to sort out fact from fiction. When Richard stated his desire to write a biography of Nick Drake, Callie realized, after cautious reflection, that here was a man who could be entrusted to sift through all the myths, seek out the buried facts, and present an accurate record of Nick's 26 years on this earth. I was perhaps more hesitant, fearing the intrusion and the reopening of a wound that never heals. But I put my trust first in Kelly, and then, as I started to know him, increasingly in Richard Morton Jack, not only in his obvious love of his subject, but in his sensitive objectivity. I knew there would be no bending of the facts to fit a personal agenda, and I also knew that I could, without compunction, give him introductions to many contacts who have in the past been reluctant to talk about Nick. What neither Callie nor I had realized was quite the lengths of investigation Richard was prepared to go to. Just how many contacts he would follow up and speak to, how many tiny pieces of evidence he would uncover and place in order, making a coherence of Nick's life that almost half a century after his death we could never have believed possible. I have no idea how enormous his database must be, but the important point is that he has sifted through all of it, culled everything of importance, and produced a book of page-turning interest. I find I've learnt many facts about my brother's life that I never knew. In life, one should never say never, but I cannot see myself ever visiting this story again. I now feel satisfied that it has been told as fully and accurately as, at the moment, it possibly can be. I'm grateful to Richard for having peeled back layers of confusion and inaccurate information. I'm equally grateful to him for having indeed trodden lightly on my dreams. For me, the rest is silence. For you, I hope, this book will lead you to listen, or perhaps re-listen, to its subject's creations, the songs of Nick Drake.
Remember this when you are full of woe. There is a time when every sigh must end. So often do we think of time as foe, we do forget that time can be a friend. Molly Drake, written in Nick's autograph book, 3rd of January 1956. Prologue. Shortly before 1 p.m. on Monday, the 25th of November, 1974, Rodney Drake happened to ring home from the local garden centre. Aged 66, he had retired 4 years earlier and was engaged in winter preparations for his roses. His wife, Molly, answered, though it could just as easily have been their car-end housekeeper, Noor, and asked him to return at once to their house, Farlees, in Tanworth in Arden, 13 miles north of Stratford-upon-Avon, Warwickshire. It was a 15-minute drive, and she came out of the house to meet him. I could tell by her face what had happened, he wrote in his diary a few hours later. Noor had looked in on Nick at 11:45, found him lying across his bed, and called to Molly, who went in and found him dead. An empty pill bottle was close by. Nick, their 26-year-old son, had been based at Farlees since the spring of 1971, following a sharp decline in his mental health, and his illness had come to define his parents' lives. By now, the 3 low-selling albums he had made were well in the past. The last had been completed over 3 years earlier, and though he had made attempts to write and record in recent months, his muse had seemingly vanished. That was one plausible reason for his despondency, but no one understood what had made this promising young man, a popular schoolboy, a champion athlete, an open-minded traveller, a Cambridge undergraduate, a superb musician, a unique singer-songwriter, so introverted, unsettled, and unhappy. Family, friends, and doctors had done their best to reverse his decline, to no avail. He had been prescribed different medicines, but took them haphazardly, and at best they controlled his symptoms rather than eliminating them. He had spent part of the previous month in Paris and shown glimmers of improvement, but in recent days he had been silent, surly, restless, inactive, and indecisive, all the characteristics his parents and sister, Gabrielle, had come to associate with the worst of his illness. Enough was enough, he had evidently decided on impulse. Eventually the local GP, Dr. Aykroyd, arrived and explained what was already clear. Nick had died some hours earlier. An ambulance was sent away, and Rodney and Molly gave statements to a sympathetic policeman, PC Howell. They told him that the contents of the pill bottle, a prescribed antidepressant, triptazole, were missing. Later, undertakers Dyson Richards arrived to remove our poor old Nick after we had said goodbye to him, Rodney wrote. We were left in a daze of grief, wondering how and why it had all come about. Rodney, Molly, and Gabrielle would never cease to ponder those questions, but their grief was softened not just by time, but by a curious phenomenon. The artistic recognition their cherished son had craved was growing and growing. Articles about him began to appear. His work was repackaged and sold more and more copies. Fans from Britain, Europe, America, and even further afield turned up at Farley's to learn more about him, and his family did their best to explain who the magically gifted, frustratingly unfathomable Nick had been. Part 1. Chapter 1. A Very Cozy World. The Drakes moved into Farley's in late May 1952, when Gabrielle was 8 and Nick was nearly 4. A large but not cavernous mock Georgian house built in the early 20th century, its asking price of £10,000 was above their budget, but it was precisely what Molly had been hoping to find upon settling in England after many years out east. Tanworth in Arden had been plain Tanworth until the 19th century, when it was renamed to avoid confusion with the market town of Tamworth in Staffordshire on the other side of Birmingham. The area had once sat in the ancient Forest of Arden. By the 1950s, it was long since denuded. Farley's took its name from the surrounding meadows, but it wasn't in deep countryside. The train that carried Rodney to work in Birmingham, 15 miles away, could be glimpsed in the distance. The heart of the village was its pretty green, bordered by the handsome 14th century limestone church, St. Mary Magdalene, and the Bell Inn. Bates Lane, where Farley's stands, was off the village centre, and the house was set back from the road, making it secluded without being isolated. A short, gravelled driveway led to its front door, flanked by pillars. Inside was a hallway with a large study to the right. In recent years, it had served as a doctor's surgery and a playgroup classroom, but was used by the Drakes as a lumber room, then as what they called the music room. Leading off it and overlooking the sweeping lawn to the back was the drawing room. A passageway led to a compact dining room and a pantry, with the kitchen at its end. Upstairs were a nursery, a dressing room, 3 bedrooms and 2 bathrooms. Nick's cosy, square room was tucked away down its own very short corridor between his sister's and parents' rooms. A tall bookshelf was set in an alcove to the right of the door, and a window, with animal print curtains when he was a child, was opposite. To the right were twin beds, a desk and chair, and a circular window overlooking the side of the house. Until he was 8, he shared his room with his bespectacled Karen nanny, Noor Rosie Portun, known as Nan. The Karen people are indigenous to the Thailand-Burma border region. Persecuted by the Burmese, they were loyal to the British, particularly during the Second World War. Nan had accompanied the Drakes back to England in 1951, and was more like a family member than an employee. It was like having 3 parents.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.